The gospel reading is taken from the Gospel of John, the 20th chapter, beginning at verse 1, concluding at verse 18. We've printed the wrong text. This is next week's gospel lesson. I think I'll preach on the one that I need to, so my apologies. So it's we won't have it up there, so you might want to get out your Bibles. It's page 141. Gospel of John, chapter 20, verses 1 through 18. Listen to and for the word of God. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father, but go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. This is the word of the Lord. Whatever forms of despair, discouragement, disillusionment, and doubt that you bring to church with you this day, a new way of living is available because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Whatever you bring this day, whatever despair, whatever disillusionment, whatever discouragement, whatever doubt, there's a new way of living available in the midst of very real and profound things. A new way of living because Jesus was raised from the dead. There is hope because of the empty tomb. Culture has done something to Easter as well as to all the Christian major liturgical days that are just off the mark. There are three individuals at the pearly gates of heaven, and St. Peter tells them that they can enter the gate if they can answer one question. So St. Peter asked the first, What is Easter? That individual replies, oh, that's easy. It's the holiday in November where everyone gathers around and eats turkey and mashed potatoes and cranberry sauce. It's a great time for the family. St. Peter just shakes his head and says, well, not so much. Looks at the next individual, says, what is Easter? That individual says, I'm really sorry for my friend's response, but this is what Easter is. It's that day in December where we give gifts to one another, and we're excited about Jesus being born, and we celebrate the light coming into the world. And St. Peter just shakes his head and says, oh my goodness, no. At least you mentioned Jesus, but you're just as off as your friend. The third one said, I know exactly what Easter is. And St. Peter said, well, I sure hope so. Please tell us. And the individual says, Easter is that day when we remember all that Jesus accomplished for humanity. How he lived obediently to the Father's will on earth, and he suffered, and he reframed Passover. He set the Lord's Supper into motion. He died on the cross, a horrible death, and they took him into the tomb. He was dead, and they closed the tomb and put a rock in front of it. But every year, Jesus moves that stone, and he comes out. And if he sees his shadow, he knows there's 6 more weeks of winter. St. Peter said, oh, this is not a good day. These people believe in Jesus, but they're missing the point. Oh, I'm not trying to be negative on culture. But today is the day where Christians gather and remember that history was changed, that death was conquered, that hope was made available. That no matter what humanity faces, faith in Jesus Christ says death will not win. Despair will not win. Disillusionment, discouragement, doubt will not win. There's hope. Hope is the expectation of the future that God has promised. Hope is the expectation that what God has ordained for humanity will not only be true in eternal life, but that there is hope for each and every day for humans to believe that whatever form death has in our lives, it will not have the last word. We simply need to believe that Jesus conquered death. Do any of you need to hear that word of hope today? Despair, discouragement, disillusionment, disappointment, doubt, those are real things. We face those every day. There's some form of discouragement, some form of doubt. I'll pick on me. Every day, one of those D words shows up. But I know that God has promised me a future, and I have hope that whatever the reality of that day, it will not have the last word. Oh, I believe in Jesus. I know he's conquered death. And there's no quick fix often to some of the things we face. But I know that God will see me through, because God's future and God's plans for humanity are all about salvation. Not simply for eternal life, but for salvation today. The psalmist in Psalm 118, I hope you caught that phrase, where David, who faced all kinds of disappointment in his life, disillusionment in his life, because of his behavior of doubting and not believing God, the psalmist says, David says, I cried out to God, and God answered me, for you, O God, are my salvation. Wow. Do any of you want to experience the hope of God's salvation in your life today? I'm not talking about eternal life. I'm talking about whatever you're facing this day that's wearing you down. Would you not like to say, I cried out to you, God, you answered me, for you are my salvation. God, through Jesus Christ, gives hope in whatever we're facing. I've been preaching Easter Sundays for almost 34 years. And the message never changes. Nor should it. But we need to believe and know this day that death, despair, discouragement, disillusionment, doubt do not have the last word, because Jesus came back from the dead, was raised from the dead, the tomb was empty. Mary went to the tomb that early morning in the dark. I just love the biblical stories. You know, Mary Magdalene was so loved by Jesus, but she, like Nicodemus, they don't want anyone to know they're looking for Jesus in the daylight. They don't want to be associated with Jesus. Do you think people in the 21st century are embarrassed? Well, I'm not embarrassed. And you say, well, you're a professional Christian, so you shouldn't be. Do you think people today really don't want others to know they're Christian? I mean, Mary went in the dark. She really didn't want to be seen. I think Mary had a little discouragement. Like, that was a bummer Good Friday scene. She was there. She watched Jesus die. So John, the text says, early in the morning, in the dark, Mary went to the tomb, and she could have been going there to do a traditional Jewish burial anointing. She could have been going because she thought maybe Jesus was raised, but she went in the dark. So I think she might have had a little discouragement, a little despair, a little disappointment about the events of the week. You know, it all started kind of bad on Palm Sunday. Jesus, the king, going in on a donkey. Jesus getting betrayed by Judas. Jesus beat up. Jesus crucified like a common. I mean, it's not a good week. She goes there, the stone's away, and Jesus isn't there. He's gone. She runs to go find Simon, Peter, and John, the one whom Jesus loved. And this is what she says. It's a paraphrase, but you can look and get it literally. But she says this. He's not there. They've taken him. Well, I don't know about you, but that's not a high degree of, hey, he's raised from the dead. No, they're saying they've taken him. Now here's some of the theories. That the Roman guards took him, so later in the day they could parade him through the streets and mock Christianity. Another theory, and these theories have some academic credibility, it's a mystery. I heard them all at Princeton and had to write exams, and I still ended up believing in the resurrection. I thought these theories took more faith than the resurrection. Another theory is the disciples took him and hid him somewhere because they didn't want to look bad. Like, hey, the resurrection has to happen, so we'll go get him. We'll just tuck him away somewhere. Another theory is Jesus really only fainted and passed out on the cross. And he finally woke up in the tomb and had enough strength to push the stone away. And then he kind of disappeared, a little bit disoriented, eventually caught up with everybody on the road to Emmaus. They've taken him. Well, Simon Peter and John, they run back. And they see the linen cloths. And then the one that was around his head just kind of neatly wrapped up and set aside. And Simon Peter, consistent with prior behavior, and now John, the one to love, they said, well, he's gone, we're going home. They leave Mary there. Mary is weeping. Weeping. The angels say, why are you weeping? But then a voice says, for whom are you looking for? It was Jesus. She thought it was a gardener, but it was Jesus. And Jesus says, don't look for me. I'm here. Mary went told that he's alive. They didn't take him. He's alive. What happened that day in Mary's life? Jesus, by speaking to her, gave her hope that her discouragement and despair would not have the last word, to keep believing by faith. You see, the power of the empty tomb, which is hard for many to believe, it doesn't make sense for dead people to come back to life. It doesn't make sense. But Jesus did come back from the dead. They still haven't found him if he was tucked away somewhere. He came back from the dead. James C. Gugel, the executive director for the Reformed Theology Foundation, says this. The question that Jesus asked Mary is filled with a profound assumption. The assumption, whom are you looking for? The assumption is, he's been raised from the dead. God's been raised from the dead. The assumption that's in that question is that it's true that Jesus came back from the dead. And the fact of the resurrection gives Christians courage to face whatever difficulty, despair, disappointment we're facing, or whatever societal issue that is causing despair, disappointment, disillusionment. Christians bring hope. Because every human being, every situation, every act of terrorism, every act of hate, every act of discouragement is begging the question, whom are you looking for? And the gospel says, he is raised from the dead. He has conquered whatever you are facing. That's the word of hope to those families in Belgium. That's the word of hope to those families in San Bernardino. That's the word of hope to those families in Paris. That's the word of hope to those families in Sandy Hook, in theaters where crazy people do crazy things. Christians need to live hope in the midst of real life situations that impact real people with great despair, great difficulty, great disappointment. That is the promise of resurrection. The Acts text, set in context, is following the resurrection. Simon Peter went about doing, witnessing to the truth of that resurrection. And he showed up in Joppa to the house of Simon the Tanner. Now, I know you know this, but let me remind you. Orthodox Jews are not to be around anybody who works with death or is associated with dead things. Well, a tanner is dealing with dead animals. And Simon Peter stays in this house. It was appalling to the religious leaders. There were religious leaders very discouraged, very disappointed in Simon Peter. But he stayed there and he had a vision. And God dropped a sheet in this vision down from heaven, representing the four corners of the earth, and every reptile, animal, living thing known to man, some that would have been considered kosher, others not so much. And God said three times to Peter, eat. Peter said no. At least Peter's consistent. God says eat. Peter says no. God says eat. Peter says no. Finally, God says, look. Don't you tell me anything that I say is clean is unclean. Do you think people need to hear that message today? That God is not partial. God doesn't play to his favorites. Do you think anybody is wondering if God can really love them today? Are any of you wondering if God can really love you? God doesn't play favorites. God doesn't show partiality. God is a God of hope, wanting to fulfill God's plans for your life, for society, for the world, in and through people that believe that the resurrection happened. Because without Jesus conquering death, there is no hope, people. Not seriously. Without Jesus conquering death, there is no hope to alleviate the fear that ISIS is producing in people's lives. But I know because Jesus conquered death, Jesus has conquered hate, Jesus has conquered terrorism, and I will continue to believe in this Jesus and love people and hope to point people who are motivated by fear. If I could have a little private meeting with the ISIS leaders, I would love to give this sermon. You can chuckle. I'm serious. People that are motivated by hate are asking or hearing the question, whom are you looking for? They're on a search. Every human being is on a search for hope. Now you think about that today. What's your search? I leave you with this on this. What's your search? What did you bring into the building today, into the sanctuary? What despair, what disillusionment, what disappointment? I bet if you look at it, you're searching for something. And you're disappointed because you haven't found what you're looking for. You know, people are looking for love and self-confidence. People are looking for hope. People are looking for a better way of living. Everybody's looking for something. Who are you looking for? And Jesus says, I'm here. Trust me. Believe this day. I will give you salvation today. In your real life, real situation, I will show you hope that whatever you're dealing with will not have the last word. The last thought, I want to read it. My manuscripts are like Linus's blanket. So I never read my manuscripts, but I want to read this last paragraph because I don't want to mess it up. God does not show partiality or favor to one particular group or another. God offers hope, restoration, and salvation to all people. That's the deal. Because of the empty tomb, hope, restoration, and salvation is offered to all people 24/7, every day of the year. And we as Christians are responsible for bearing witness to that truth. How can you this day bear witness to somebody who is looking for hope? How can you bear witness to how God has given you salvation in something with which you're struggling? And bear witness to one of your neighbors or one of your friends. And witness sometimes is just you living your life with hope, which then begs the question by your friend. Who did that person find? Who did my friend find that's giving them help in this situation? Christians are to bear witness to that good news. The resurrection of Jesus Christ not only constitutes the defeat of death, but also despair, discouragement, and doubt. Because of Jesus' resurrection, we are given hope. Easter is a celebration of hope. Easter is Christians gathering to celebrate hope, because in Jesus Christ there is new life now and forevermore. Amen.